Praise the Lord. Rise up as we pray together. I want you to present yourself before the Lord. That the Bible study today will enrich your soul, enlighten you, and make you to know what the Lord has for us in these last days. And that the understanding of the prophecy of the word will make you to get prepared so that you will be the kind of person the Lord wants you to be, rapturable, holy, sanctified, pure, ready for the coming of the Lord. Can I hear you pray? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our Father, we thank you very much for our Bible study. Thank you for bringing us back together again. Thank you for the book of Daniel. Thank you for Daniel himself, the prophet. Thank you for your spirit that worked in him and prophesied through him. And thank you, Lord, for the spirit of God watching over the word, even until this time. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us to this point in the study. We pray, Lord, you enlighten everyone, challenge everyone, prepare every one of us in Jesus' name. And we're praying, oh Lord, as we hear the study today and we learn, we'll not just be learners, we'll be teachers as well. So that we'll take your word and go and impact the lives of other people in Jesus' name. We'll pray for everyone in all the locations, those who are listening, as we're blessing us here, bless them as well in Jesus' name. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. We can sit down. We come to Daniel now, chapter 12. We've been in the book of Daniel for many months now. We've gone through chapter 1 through to chapter 11. If you remember what we learned at the end of chapter 11, we learned about the coming of the Antichrist. And we learned of that time of the great tribulation. As we look back to Daniel chapter 11, verse 35, and some of them of understanding shall fall to try them and to purge and to make them white, even at the time of the end. Notice that, even at the time of the end. And so you see that Daniel has continued the prophecy and is now coming to the time of the end. Look at verse 14. And at the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots and with horsemen and with many ships. And he shall enter into the countries and shall overflow and pass over. You notice once again in that verse 40, and at the time of the end. So that you see the prophecy of Daniel as led from the beginning, from the time of the Babylonian Empire to the time of the Grecian Empire, and to the time of the Medo-Persian Empire, then to the time of the Roman Empire. We've studied that in chapter 2. We've studied that in chapter 4 as well. And then we've been seeing from chapter 7, chapter 8, and chapter 9, 10, and 11, how the progressive governments of the world, the Gentile governments, will be reigning and ruling over the people. And at that time, Israel will be trodden under the feet of men. Actually, the Lord Jesus Christ spoke about this. As we look at Luke chapter 21, verse 24, Luke chapter 21, verse 24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. It's talking about the children of Israel, that they will fall. That is, there will be all these kingdoms of the world and nations of the world and armies of the world fighting against them. And many of them will be slain, they will be killed, and they will fall. And then it says, those who are not killed will be led captive to all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And that is what Daniel is referring to. Daniel is saying that at the time of the end, that is when the culmination, the climax, the conclusion of the Gentile kingdoms will come, then at that time God will begin to work again for the children of Israel. As we look at chapter 12, let's look at verse 4. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. You see that Daniel is concentrating on the time of the end. He wasn't talking about that time when he lived, or even the time when Jesus came, or even all these thousands of years since Jesus died on the cross. He's going as far as to the second coming of the Lord, as to the time of the Antichrist, as to the time when the children of Israel will remember their Messiah, their Christ, under the persecution of the Antichrist and the great pressure that will come upon them in the time of the great tribulation. Then will they call upon the Lord. That's the time he's referring to. Look at verse 9. And he said, "Go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end." And so there's no mistake as to what Daniel was talking about. Talking about the time of the end. Let's look at verse 1 now that we're studying today. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. And at that time, now you understand, that time. What time? The time of the Antichrist. What time? The time of the greatest persecution that the children of Israel had ever experienced in their lives. What time? The 3.5 years period that the intensity of the persecution, of the pressure, the tribulation, the trouble will be so great, and then they'll be calling upon their Lord. It says, "At that time shall Michael stand up, that great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble." That's it right there. A time of trouble. When you say trouble, you say trial, you say temptation, you say tribulation, they all mean the same thing for the children of Israel. It will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. It's telling us it will be the greatest of the suffering they ever had, the most intense of the sufferings they ever had, and the most painful suffering they ever went through in their lives as a nation. Because it says, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. Can I show you how Jesus Christ used that same terminology? The time that had never been before, the kind of suffering, the kind of pressure, the kind of persecution, and the kind of pain they had never had before. Let's come to Matthew chapter 24. In Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 29 and verse 30. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ now said, this is called the tribulation. Come to verse 21. Then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. Can you see that language? The same language that Daniel used, which means that Daniel was talking about the time of the great tribulation. And Jesus Christ said that time, it will be a time of suffering, such suffering that they had never experienced in all the troubles and trials and tribulations that they ever went through since they became a nation. It says, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. In verse 22, and except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, that's talking about the children of Israel who are chosen, who are elected, who are selected by the Lord. For the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. And then the Lord said, immediately after that great tribulation, verse 29 now, and immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with great power and great glory. What's that telling us? It's telling us that after the great tribulation, there will be the second coming of Christ to establish the millennial reign. So then we know that Daniel gives this prophecy concerning a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation. You've seen in the passage I read to you that the Lord Jesus Christ referred to that same period, and he called it the period of the great tribulation. And it wasn't only Daniel, and not only the Lord Jesus Christ that referred to the great tribulation from the time of Moses. Moses had known in prophetic foresight that that time of the great tribulation was coming. Let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 30 and verse 31. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30. Here Moses was talking to the people and he said, when thou art in tribulation, and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days. That means he wasn't talking about his own time, or the time of Joshua, or the time of David, or the time before Christ will come the first time. He's talking about the latter days, the end of time, the same time that Daniel was talking about. And Moses said it will be a time of the great tribulation. And then he said, if thou turn to the Lord thy God, thou shalt be obedient, for the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he has sworn unto them. So then we understand that the time of the great tribulation had been prophesied from the time of Moses. In fact, Jeremiah spoke about that. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 30. And we're reading from verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 30. We're looking at it from verse 4. And you'll see that these prophets of old, they saw it coming. And they warned the nation of Israel. That's the characteristic of a true prophet of God. You see judgment coming, you warn the people of God. And you see that the punishment for iniquity, the national iniquity is coming, you will warn the people of God. Look at chapter 30 of Jeremiah verse 4. It says, and these are the words that the Lord spake concerning Israel and concerning Judah. For thus says the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling and fear, and of fear, and of not of peace. Ask now, ask ye now, and see whether a man does travail with child. That's talking of whether a woman, when a woman is under labor pain. But he says, how is this happening? Ask now whether a man can be pregnant and have labor pains like a woman. Wherefore do I see every man with his hands on his loins as a woman in travail, and all faces are turned into paleness. And now he explains why. And he tells us what that time will be. And it's referring to the time of the great tribulation. Look at verse 7. Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. He'll pass through it, many of them will die, and then a remnant of them will be saved. As Moses spoke about it, Jeremiah spoke about it, Isaiah spoke about it, chapter 24 of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 1. Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty, and maketh it waste, and turneth it upside down, and scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof. Now Moses said it will happen to the children of Israel. And then Jeremiah said it will happen to Judah and Israel. Isaiah is saying it will not be limited to Judah alone, or Israel alone, or Jerusalem alone, that the great tribulation will affect the whole earth. The whole earth. The pressure, the pain, the persecution, the suffering, the trouble, the tribulation. It will not be limited to just a geographical location. It will circle the whole earth. That's why it says, look at verse 3, the land shall be utterly emptied and utterly spoiled, for the Lord has spoken this word. The great tribulation is described as being full of wars and full of judgments and full of famine and full of wars and plagues and terror, anguish and earthquakes. This is the time that that will happen after the rapture. The true church, and I pray you'll be part of that true church. You are born again, you are a child of God, you are living by the grace of God according to the way he wants you to live. You are part of the true church. We will not go through the tribulation. But the people who just go to church, I mean the nominal church, the people that have a name that they live but they are dead, they will pass through that great tribulation, and thank God you will escape in Jesus' name. At that time of the tribulation, many people will suffer, and some at that time will repent, praise the Lord, but some, a lot of the people, the pain will be so much on them, they will not be able to repent. We're looking at it very closely now in Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 12, we're looking at it in detail. We're looking at verse 1. We're going to divide the study tonight to three parts. Number one, definite prediction of the great tribulation. The prediction of the great tribulation. Daniel said it, Moses said it, and Jeremiah said it, and Joel even spoke about it, as well as Amos and Zephaniah. And then we'll come to Matthew and Mark and Luke and Revelation, all speaking about the great tribulation. It's predicted, it's prophesied, it is coming. I pray you will escape it. Number two, divine purging during the great tribulation. One of the purposes of the Lord in bringing the tribulation upon Israel in particular and upon the world in general is that he'll purge iniquity out of the hearts of the people that are willing to respond to his word. Number three, desired preservation after great triumph. There'll be people that will go through that and then they're going to preserve. The Lord will save them. The Lord will call them to himself. As the pain and the punishment and the pressure and all the things coming upon them will turn their hearts to know the Lord. Let's start from number one. Number one, definite prediction of the great tribulation. Let's come to chapter 12 of Daniel, verse 1. And at that time, now you know the time. It's the time of the end. Now you know the time. It's the time after the rapture of the church. Now you know the time. It's called 70th week of Daniel. You know the time. It is time when the Antichrist will sit upon the in the temple, upon the throne of God, claiming that he is God. Now you know the time. It is when the king of fierce countenance will come, and then he will defy the laws of God and try to change the times and the laws. And at that time, at which time, it will be a time when God will just turn his sight away and will turn the covenant promises away from the children of Israel, and he let loose the powers of hell and the powers of demons and the powers of the devil against the children of Israel because they are forsaking the Lord. And at that time, at what time? It will be at the time when the kingdoms of the world will have a unified kingdom, and then there will be a king over them, and that king of fierce countenance will be called the Antichrist. He will oppose everything that belongs to Christ. At that time, we're told, the children of Israel will suffer a lot. Let's go on. At that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble. That's the tribulation. Such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. That's the time we're looking at now, the prediction of Daniel concerning the great tribulation. He has spoken about this before in different chapters. Let's look at chapter 8. Chapter 8 of Daniel, verse 24. In verse 24 it says, and his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. This is referring to the power of the Antichrist, the might of the Antichrist, and the military prowess of the Antichrist. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. And he shall destroy woefully, terribly, wonderfully. And then he says, and shall prosper and practice, and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. Anytime you see that in the Old Testament, the holy people, you know, the children of Israel in the Old Testament, they knew only two nations, the Gentile nations on the one hand and the Israelitic nation on the other hand. And they called Israel the holy people because of the covenant, the holy covenant the Lord had with them. And then it says at that time that the Antichrist, this king with mighty power and great power, he will destroy the holy people. Look at verse 25. And through his policy also shall he cause craft, deception, evil, lying to prosper in his hand, and he shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall he destroy many. He shall also stand up against the prince of princes, that is, being an antichrist, he'll stand against Christ, against the Messiah, against the Lord himself, against the prince of peace. And then he tells us, but he shall be broken without hand. Eventually, he himself will be destroyed. Let's look at Joel. We've read Deuteronomy already, and now we've read Jeremiah, we've read Jeremy. Now we're looking at Joel chapter 1. Joel chapter 1. the time when this terrible Antichrist will come, and the time of the great tribulation. In chapter 1, verse 15, Joel chapter 1, verse 15, it tells us, alas for the day, for the day of the Lord is at hand, as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. The time of the great tribulation, what makes the great tribulation? Number one, the devil himself will be oppressing the people, and all the demons will be let loose. Not only that, the wickedness of men will come to the climax, will come to a height, and now the judgment of God will be added to that. When you think about that, in fact, the book of Revelation tells us a lot of what is going to be happening at such a time. Now, the children of Israel, they have been wondering, because it will be studying how they came to the Babylonian captivity from Daniel chapter 1. Then Daniel chapter 2, chapter 3, you remember, he raised up that great, mighty idol, and he said all of them should bow down and worship. If anybody will not worship, he's going to throw that person into the fire. That's when the faith of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shone forth, and they said, no, we're not going to bow to any idol. And then, you know, they went on and on until chapter 5, when Belshazzar rose up, and then he began to make fun of the Almighty God, and the handwriting of the Lord came upon the wall, and his knees began to shake together, and then he was destroyed. Eventually, we're at chapter 6, and in chapter 6, Darius the king rose up, and he wanted to set Daniel above all the presidents. But then eventually now, as we see them, Daniel is seeing that 70 years of captivity is not being ended. And he was concerned, what's going to happen to the children of Israel? Will the Lord not take away their suffering and end it at this time? That's why he began to pray. And then God said, Daniel, you know what? 70 weeks are decided upon your people. The first 7 weeks, that is seven sevens of years, 49 years, and then another 62 weeks, and then the last one, the 70th week, that's when the time of the Antichrist, he'll make a covenant to the children of Israel. But the point is this, Daniel thought 70 weeks determined, all these 70 years are over now, suffering will end, persecution will end, and God said, Daniel, not so. It's not going to end. The children of Israel will still continue to suffer from generation to generation, because the 70 years of captivity and of suffering and of oppression did not cure them of their sin, of their rebellion, of their unrighteousness, of their evil. And because the 70 years did not cure them, that's why the suffering continued. And that's why the Lord is saying the climax of it will be the great tribulation. And let's look at this, because you know, and sometimes when you see people suffer, you'll think, he'll change now, he'll repent now, he'll turn to the Lord now. But for the children of Israel, thank God for the people that change, for the people that turn out, they say, no, I will arise and go to my father, because it's better for me when I was with my father than at this time. The prodigal son, the prodigal city, like Nineveh, the prodigal nation that were at the time of Ezekiah, when everybody just turned to the Lord in the whole nation. But you see, the nation of Israel at this time did not turn to the Lord. The 70 years of captivity did not cure them of their sin, of their evil, of their rebellion. That's why they continue to suffer and suffer, and they will suffer the greatest at the time of the great tribulation. And let's look at how God lamented concerning them. Isaiah chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 4. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 4. A sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evil doers, children that are corrupters, they are forsaking the Lord, they have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger, they are gone away backward. Why should ye be stricken anymore? Ye will revolt more and more, the whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. He said, he has stricken them, he had rebuked them, he had corrected, he had chastised them, he had laid great punishment, tribulation upon them, but then they still went on, and the Lord said, why should you be stricken anymore? Verse 6, from the sole of the foot, even unto the head thereof, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. Your country is desolate. Your cities are burnt with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence. And it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. With all that, they still did not change. Look at chapter 9 of Isaiah. We're looking at verse 13. For the people turneth not unto him that smiteth them, neither do they seek the Lord of hosts. The Lord said, this is shocking, this is surprising, that the Lord that's meeting them, chastise them, discipline them, laid punishment upon them, yet they will not turn. That's why eventually the great tribulation will come upon them. They had troubles before, they had trials before, they had pressures before, they had persecution before, they had captivity before, even 70 years, but that did not cure them. So God said, all right, I'll bring the great tribulation. Look at Jeremiah chapter 2 verse 30. Jeremiah chapter 2 verse 30. He wanted them to change. He wanted them to be corrected. He thought that the Babylonian captivity will cure them, but he didn't cure them. Because of that, now the great tribulation will come. Jeremiah chapter 2 verse 30. It tells us over here, in vain have I smitten your children. They received no correction. Your own sword have devoured your prophets like a destroying lion. He said, I've punished you in vain. I've chastised you in vain. I've laid that upon you in vain. Because he did not correct them or change them. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 5 verse 3. Chapter 5, O Lord, and not thine eyes upon the truth. Thou was tricking them, but they have not grieved. Thou was tricking them, but they have not grieved. Thou hast consumed them, but they have refused to receive correction. They have made their faces harder than a rock. They have refused to return. Because the chastisement and the punishment and the things that came upon them did not change them. The captivity, the Gentile world, the Gentile oppression did not turn them around. That's why eventually the great tribulation will come upon them. And when that great tribulation eventually comes, they will turn, they will repent, and they'll call upon the Lord their God. Zephaniah. In Zephaniah chapter 3, I'm reading verse 7. Zephaniah, very near the end of the Old Testament. Zephaniah chapter 3. We're looking at verse 7. I say, surely thou wilt fear me. Thou wilt receive instruction, so their dwelling should not be cut off. Howsoever I punish them, but they rose early and corrupted all their doings. The Lord said, I thought they would change. I thought they would turn around. I thought that the tribulation, the trouble, the trial, the oppression I bring upon them will turn them around. But the Lord said, but howsoever I punish them, howsoever I chastise them, howsoever I discipline them, they still continued in their corruption. They corrupted their ways. And they go on like that to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 16, we're looking at verse 11. Revelation chapter 16, we're looking at verse 11. And blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. Do you see then why God said tribulation will continue for the children of Israel? It will come to the climax, it will come to the height, it will come to the great tribulation, because the minor things they have gone through, the punishment they have gone through, and the chastisement they have gone through did not cure them of their evil. It's during that period of the great tribulation, the time of unprecedented distress and of the great pressure that will come upon them, that Michael the archangel will protect the remnant of Israel, who will be tried and purged and purified. The Lord is saying, I'm sending this upon them so that they'll be purged, so that they'll be purified. Let's come back to Daniel. In Daniel chapter 11 verse 35, here we see the reason why the great tribulation will come upon the children of Israel, so that they'll be punished, and that punishment will purify them, will purge them, will make them white, and then a remnant of them will turn around, will change, and that remnant will now go into the kingdom. In Daniel chapter 11 verse 35, and some of them of understanding shall fall to try them, to purge and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. Look at chapter 12 verse 10. Chapter 12 verse 10. Many shall be purified and made white and tried. It said the tribulation will try them, will purge them, will purify them, and there will be a part of them, actually one third, according to Zechariah, that eventually will say, Lord, we'll surrender. But two thirds would have died. 2/3 of them. At present now, I think the population of the children of Israel all over the world is about 15 million. And the 2/3 dying, that will mean 10 million if the tribulation were to take place now. And only 5 million, one out of three, will be able to say, oh Lord, now we understand. We know why the chastisement is there. We know why the punishment has come. We know why the great tribulation has come upon us. Now we surrender and we give ourselves to the Lord. In verse 10 of chapter 12, many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly. In the midst of that tribulation, those who are wicked will say, it doesn't matter what happens, God, do your worst or do your best, whatever you do, we'll still continue doing what we were doing. And he said, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand. They will not understand the purpose of the great tribulation. They will not know that it is to bend their will and bend their mind and bend their heart to make them turn unto the Lord. But the wise shall understand. Even today, only the wise will understand. I thank God I'm part of the wise. You are part of the wise. You'll understand in Jesus' name. And you're not going to wait until, you know, God brings a pressure, brings tribulation, brings a trial, and brings a greater thing to bear upon you before you change. Thank God, His grace and His love will draw you nearer and nearer to the Lord in Jesus' name. Zechariah chapter 13. Zechariah chapter 13, the Lord is saying, just a part of them will receive instruction. A part of them will turn, a part of them will change. Zechariah chapter 13, verse 8, and it shall come to pass that in all the land, says the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die. That's what I told you. Two parts of them shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein, only one third of them. And I will bring the third part through the fire and will refine them as silver is refined. That's the purifying process. That's the sanctifying process. When the Lord will purge them, the purging process. The Lord says, I will refine them as silver is refined and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, the Lord is my God. I pray we'll not wait for the rod before we listen to the Lord. The word of God is enough to turn us to the Lord. The love of God is enough to turn us to the Lord. The grace of God, the mercy of God, the compassion of the Lord, and the good work of the Lord upon our lives, and the miracles He does for us, that's enough to make us say, Lord, because of what you have done, we're going to serve you. We're not going to be like, you know, those people that wait for the tribulation to come upon them before they turn to the Lord. We'll say, Lord, you've done so much for us. You've saved us. You've sanctified us. You've baptized us in the Holy Ghost. We're going to worship you till the end of our lives. Your worship and your worship will be acceptable to the Lord in Jesus' name. We're looking at now point number 2, Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. Divine purging during the great tribulation. Divine purging during the great tribulation. Let's look at this in verse 1. At that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, a time of trial, a time of tribulation, great tribulation, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. Listen to this. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered. At that time, thy people shall be delivered. There'll be a part of them that will listen to the rod, a part of them that will listen to the chastisement, a part of them that will say, God, we understand. You have been patient with us, and you are doing this now. Lord, we repent. Lord, we return. Lord, we reconcile with you. Lord, we turn. And as they turn, the Lord will cleanse them and purge them, and they'll be purified. Look at this. We've read it before. Let's read it again. Chapter 11, verse 35. And some of them, some of them, you'll be part of the psalm that will understand. And you are not going to wait for the calamity to fall upon you before you turn around. Some of them shall understand, that of understanding shall fall, to try them, to purge and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. Let's look at chapter 10 of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 10. And we're looking at what the Lord is saying concerning this election, this selection, the people that will turn to the Lord. It says in chapter 10 of Isaiah verse 20, and it shall come to pass in that day that the remnant of Israel, you see that not the whole of Israel, not everybody in Israel, just the remnant, just a few remaining, the remnant of Israel, and such as are escaped of the house of Jacob, shall no more again stay upon him that smote them, but shall stay upon the Lord, the Holy One of Israel in truth. The remnant shall return, even the remnant of Jacob, unto the mighty God. It says, many of them will die, many of them will perish, but there'll be a remnant of the people that will say, Lord, we know, we understand why the judgment is coming. We understand why this chastisement is so tense and so terrible. We know why this thing we've never seen before in the nation, why it is coming upon us. Now we return, and now we repent. Now we want to be reconciled unto the Lord. They'll be reconciled. In chapter 48 of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 48, and I'm reading from verse 10 to verse 12. Behold, I've refined thee, but not with silver. I've chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. Furnace of affliction, that's the great tribulation. The Lord said, the time will come. He'll tell them, the remnant of them, the people that will turn to the Lord, I've chosen you, I've purchased you, I've redeemed you, I've refined you, I've purged and purified you, not through silver. I've chosen you in the furnace of affliction. For mine own sake, even for mine own sake, will I do it. For how should my name be polluted, and I will not give my glory unto another. Hearken unto me, O Jacob and Israel, my called, I am he, and I am the first, and I also I am the last. Malachi chapter 3. In Malachi chapter 3, it's talking about the last time again, the last days, and at this time now when the purging will take place, when the refinement will take place, and when that refinement takes place, these people, they will call upon the name of the Lord. We're looking at Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3, we're looking at it from verse 2. But who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire, like the fuller's soap. You see that? Refiner's fire. That means the furnace of affliction, the great tribulation, will act like real fire to purge them, purify them, refine them. And then in verse 3 it says, and he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver. They that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. It says when the Lord deals with them again, and when the Lord purifies and purges them all over again, they'll be able to serve the Lord acceptably. At this time now, we are being purged and purified, but thank God, not by suffering, we're purged by the blood of Jesus Christ. And I think that's better for us. Is that not better? That now you can tell the Lord, you see any impurity in your life, anything you know that the Lord is not happy with, you're not going to wait for suffering, you're not going to wait for a kind of fire of affliction, you're not going to wait to go through the fire, through the furnace. You say, Lord, I know the blood of Jesus Christ is there, and that blood will purify me and purge me, and that blood will sanctify me. And you go to the Lord in prayer, the Lord will do it in Jesus' name. But in their own case, they'll be waiting until the time of the great tribulation. And then it says, when they are purged and purified, they will serve the Lord. Let's look at verse 4. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. The Lord is saying that now when he purges and purifies them, then their sacrifices will be acceptable again. Now, how will he purge them? Is it just because the tribulation is there, and so because they have suffered, and the suffering will purge them? No, not at all. Because it's not just the suffering. There are many people, I've read it to you already, many of them that will suffer. And two sorts of them, in the fire of affliction, in the great furnace, and in the great persecution, in the great tribulation, they'll still keep on cursing the Lord. They'll still be adamant in their sin, and they'll still be rigid in their evil, and they'll still be stiff-necked and stubborn in their iniquity. And so they'll not be purged. But the people that were purged, they'll be people that their pain and their suffering will lead them to repentance. They begin to call upon the Lord, oh Lord, we're sorry. We know that we have rebelled against you. And it is that sorrow of heart and sorrow for sin that will lead them to know the Lord. Let's look at Zechariah chapter 12, and see how they will pour out their hearts before the Lord, how they will pray before the Lord. And as they pray, the Lord will have mercy upon them, because the Lord is always a merciful God. Even today, the Lord is a merciful God. I said the Lord is a merciful God. And anytime you call upon the Lord, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, that soul shall be saved, shall be forgiven, purified. And then you come into fellowship, relationship with the Lord again. Zechariah chapter 12, we're reading from verse 10. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. It says, and I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplication. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. They will look at the Messiah, they look at Christ, and they will say, this is what we did. We crucified him. Look at the print of the nails in his son. This is our sin. This is our evil. And now they realize what they have done in that great tribulation time. They'll then call upon the Lord. They pour out their souls like water before the Lord. And then the Lord will answer their prayers. Look at verse 11. In that day shall there be a great mourning in Jerusalem, as the mourning of Hadadrimmon in the valley of Megiddon. In verse 12, and the land shall mourn, every family apart, the family of the house of David apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Nathan apart, and their wives apart, and the family of the house of Levi apart, and their wives apart, and the family of Shimei apart, and their wives apart, all the families that remain, not everybody, only the remnant, the people that remain, other people, the tribulation, great tribulation, will destroy them, and will make their hearts hard. The suffering will harden them, and they will not repent. But there will be a remnant, the people that remain, all the families that remain, every family apart and their wives apart. These will call upon the Lord, and as they call upon the Lord will answer them. Today, if we call upon the Lord will answer us in Jesus' name. You know, anytime anybody calls upon the Lord, whether it's the time of peace or the time of pain, the time of suffering or the time of joy, the time of sadness or the time of gladness, anytime we call upon the Lord is always there. He will not say, well, this is a peaceful time, you are calling upon the Lord, I will not answer. He answers. Or this is a painful time and you are calling upon the Lord will answer. You know, some people say, you know what drove me to the Lord? You know what brought me to salvation? I was sick. I was in problem. I was having pain. I lost everything I've got. And that pressure, that pain, that terrible time brought me to the Lord. I called upon the Lord and the Lord answered. Yes, you are right. When you call upon the Lord, he answers. Even though it's a time of pain, other people say, you know, my own case was different. I came to the Lord in a time of peace and prosperity, because I just looked around me and I saw the peace and the joy, and my family was settled. And I said, God is so wonderful. See what God has done for me. And in gratitude to the Lord, I came to the Lord. So, at the time of peace or prosperity, you call upon the Lord, he will answer. And at the time of pain and pressure, you call upon the Lord, he will answer as well. He always answers. The time of the great tribulation is the period of the reign of the Antichrist. It will be a time of special distress and desolation for the children of Israel, and even for the whole world. The 7-year period will be a time of unprecedented trouble, unprecedented terror, as well as tribulation. The last 3.5 years of that period, that is the last half of the 7 years, will be more intense and terrible and frightening. Revelation chapter 6 to verse 19, to chapter 19, it give us its frightening details. What does it say? As you remember what we learned in the book of Revelation, this is what it says: the time of tribulation, number one, be a time of war; number two, a time of famine; number three, a time of death; terrible death, you know, taking the people, and people just dying here and there because of the war and the pestilence and all the diseases. For one quarter of the world will be slain in a short period of time. Five, there will be the collapse of the heavenly bodies. They're just falling upon people. The stars falling. And then, number six, one third of the earth will be destroyed. Number seven, one third of the sea will be poisoned and destroyed. And number eight, one third of the fresh water will be poisoned and polluted. So that the people that drink that, many of them are going to die. Many people will suffer and die. There will be the release of the demons from the bottomless pit to torment men on earth. Then the sun will come up with great heat. Scorching sunlight will burn many people to death. The wickedness of men will be so much. And then the demons and the antichrist, their wickedness will know no limits. And God also will send punishment in devastating judgment upon Israel and upon the whole world in the final act of purging. After millions of people in Israel and billions of people in the world, all over the world, have lost their lives, then a remnant of Israel will return and repent and renew their covenant with the Almighty God. And the Bible says only a remnant that will be saved among the children of Israel. Only a remnant will call upon the Lord. Let's look at the New Testament in Romans chapter 9, verse 27. Romans chapter 9, we're looking at verse 27. Many people will die, many people will perish, and they perish and go to hell. They suffer the great tribulation. And then because the great tribulation did not turn them to the Lord, and did not make them to call upon the Lord, they suffer here on earth, and then they go to hell to continue the suffering. Romans chapter 9, verse 27. Isaiah also cries, concerning Israel. He's talking about Isaiah now. Isaiah cried concerning Israel. Though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. You see that? Only a remnant. Only few of them, one third out of the millions of the children of Israel, will be saved. And of course, in the whole world too, many people, they will lose their lives because of not repenting of their evil. Chapter 11, verse 5. This is Romans chapter 11, verse 5. Even so then, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. Only a remnant of those people are going to be saved. But let's look at Joel, that anyone that will call upon the Lord, it's not that God predestined them to perish and God said, no, I'm not going to save them. It's only the people that call upon the name of the Lord that shall be saved. Just like today, anyone that calls upon the name of the Lord today will be saved. No matter what you have done, no matter how far you have gone, and no matter the wickedness or the terrible sin that anybody would have committed, the mercy of God is made available. It's only that people are not calling upon the name of the Lord. That's why they are perishing. That's why they are suffering. But if you will say, Lord, I know my fault, I know my sin, I know my evil, and I'm sorry for what I've done, and I genuinely repent, and I renew my covenant with you, our God is merciful and will forgive in Jesus' name. Joel chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 13. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. This is the time of the great tribulation now. And the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. You see that? That even at that time, when the moon is turning to blood, and when the sun is turning to darkness, and when those terrible calamities will be upon the world, yet it says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. We don't have to wait for that time of the great tribulation. This time now is the time of salvation and the time of the mercy of God. And the mercy of God will be upon your life, upon my life, upon our lives together in Jesus' name. We come to point number 3, desired preservation after great triumph. We're coming back to Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12. And you'll see the mercy of God for the remnant, for the people that will remain. And the Lord will say, I'm going to preserve them. My anger is going to be limited. And when I see that the people repent, then I'm going to turn them away from all those calamities. Let's come back to chapter 12 of Daniel. Daniel chapter 12, we're reading from verse 1. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered. And at that time thy people shall be what? Tell me out loud. Delivered. Well, before we go on, do you know something? It doesn't matter how terrible the world is. It doesn't matter how terrible the pain may be. It doesn't matter how terrible a tribulation, a time of calamity may be. Those who will be saved will be saved. I said those who will be saved will be saved. You see, at the time of the great tribulation, that's the time when a kind of suffering comes upon the world that had never been in the history of the world. And yet it says, thy people shall be delivered. Which tells us that, you know, sometimes we're thinking the trouble is so much in the world. There's recession. There's poverty. Many people are losing their jobs. And look at the condition of things in the world. The natural disasters and the earthquake and everything. This one taking place and that one taking place. How will anybody get saved? Those who want to get saved will still get saved. No matter the sickness, no matter the suffering, and no matter the pain, and no matter the pressure, those who will be saved will still be saved. With the wickedness of the people of the world there, the pressure of the Antichrist, and the painful things they were going through, and yet there will be people that will call upon the Lord. If there are people that will call upon the Lord at the most terrible time in the history of the world, how about at this time now, when all that has not started happening, we can call upon the Lord, we can have the mercy of God, we can have the salvation of the Lord, and salvation and deliverance will be ours in Jesus' name. At that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. And that's what Jeremiah is telling us. Look at Jeremiah once again. We read it before, but did you notice in chapter 30 of Jeremiah and the latter part of verse 7? Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble. Look at the last part there. But he shall be saved out of it. The great tribulation will not consume everybody. The great tribulation will not destroy everybody. There'll be people that will call upon the name of the Lord. There'll be people that will repent. There'll be people that become righteous. There'll be people that will be reconciled unto the Lord. There'll be people that will say, Lord, we know this is coming because of our sin, because of our rebellion, because of our evil. This is coming upon us because of turning away from the Lord. But we're going to call upon the name of the Lord. And as you call upon the name of the Lord will have mercy. And let's tell one another that you see anybody suffering, a sinner suffering, a neighbor suffering, a co-tenant suffering, and they say, look at what has happened to me. Tell them the mercy of God is still there. Tell them the salvation of God is still there. Tell them the forgiveness of the Lord is still there. Let nobody lose hope just because of what is happening to him. Because the God that we serve is a God of covenant. And he keeps covenant, and he's a loving God, and he's a merciful, a compassionate God is only waiting for genuine repentance upon our part. And once that repentance is there, I believe that mercy will come in Jesus' name. He shall be saved out of it. And that's the glory of the majesty of God and the mercy of the Lord, that he saves people and then he gives them the mercy when they didn't even think they merit any mercy at all. It is not by merit, it is by mercy. And that mercy will flow to everyone of us in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 11. Isaiah chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 11. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand against the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be led from Assyria and from Egypt and from Pathros and then from Cush and from Phlam And then it says, I'm from China and from Hamas and from the islands of the sea. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations and shall assemble the outcast of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. You see, that's the mercy of God. It says, at that time, even at that time of suffering, of the tribulation, of the persecution, of the pain upon them, the Lord will still deliver. He'll deliver the people. And if the Lord will deliver the people at such a terrible time, great tribulation time, how about today? Every time the Lord says, I'm God, I change not, he's still delivering. He will deliver us in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 27, verse 12. Isaiah 27. I'm reading from verse 12. It tells us in verse 12, it says, and it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall beat off from the channel of the river unto the stream of Egypt, and ye shall be gathered one by one, O ye children of Israel. And it shall come to pass in that day that the great trumpet shall be blown, and they shall come which were ready to perish in the land of Assyria, and the outcasts of the land of Egypt, and shall worship the Lord in the holy mount of Jerusalem. They'll come back and they offer true worship unto the Lord. And let's come to Isaiah chapter 26. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 20, verse 21. The Lord is appealing to the people now at the time of that great tribulation, at the time of that great pressure and pain and suffering upon the people. He's appealing to them, and the people that have ears to hear. And as he will appeal to them at that time, he's appealing to you and to me and to us at this time as well. In Isaiah chapter 26, verse 20, come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself as it were for a moment until the indignation be overpassed. See the Lord counseling the people and see him saying, there's indignation, there is wrath, there is judgment, there is tribulation, there's trouble. Come, my people, those who want to be the people of God, who want to escape the terrible judgment coming upon the world, come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers, shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself as it were for a little moment, because the great tribulation is not forever. It's just for a short time. And it says, hide yourself in the mercy of God. Hide yourself in the presence of the Lord. For behold, the Lord cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. And the earth also shall disclose her blood, and shall no more cover her slain. At that time, the Lord is saying, hide yourself from those evil things that are coming upon the land. Sin and suffering will reach their apex, their climax during the great tribulation. Yet, there will be the great triumph for those who cleave unto the Lord. Though there will be great distress, there will be great deliverance as well through the great deliverer. Those who know their God and receive his abundant grace will always be triumphant over sin, triumphant over Satan, triumphant over suffering as well. Even during the most terrible period of suffering, during the period of the great abomination and tribulation, there will still be a remnant who will be purified and preserved to enter into Christ's millennial kingdom. That's why it says, at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. Let's look at Romans again. Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11, and see the promise the Lord was making to the children of Israel, and the promise he's making to you and to me, to us as well. Romans chapter 11. We're reading from verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceit, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be coming. The Lord is showing mercy to the Gentiles right now. And the Gentiles are getting saved. They are not waiting for the time of the great tribulation before they get saved. And they are calling upon the Lord. And the Lord is healing them and delivering them and saving them and blessing them. And the church is growing in the Gentile world. At present now, Israel is blindfolded. Israel is deaf and blind to the truth of the gospel. But it says, Gentiles, don't be ignorant of this. The time of mercy for the children of Israel is still coming. Verse 26, and so all Israel, that means all remaining Israel, All those who have died, they have died, but all those who remain, the remnant, all Israel shall be saved. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. The deliverance is not just to deliver them and remain in their sin, or to save them and remain in their evil, or to pardon them and remain in their evil. It shall turn away iniquity, ungodliness, unrighteousness, evil, sin away from Jacob. In verse 27, for this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. That's what the Lord will do. Let's come back to Daniel chapter 12 and see the latter part of that verse 1. Daniel chapter 12 verse 1. Let me read from the beginning. Now you understand Daniel chapter 1, chapter 12 verse 1. And at that time, the time of the Antichrist, and at that time, the time of the great tribulation, shall Michael, that's the archangel, defending the children of Israel as a nation, he shall stand up. That great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, that's the great angel standing for the defense of the children of Israel. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found, how? Written in the book. Everyone that shall be found written in the book. The question is, what kind of book is that? That's the book of life. How is somebody's name written in the book? When somebody becomes born again, when somebody becomes saved, you turn away from your sin, and then as you turn away from your sin, you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whosoever shall call on the name of Jesus shall be saved. And then the guilt of sin is taken away. The penalty of sin, the punishment of sin is also taken away. And the pollution of sin is also cleansed away. And when you are cleansed like that, you are taken away from the community of sinful people. You are taken away from the company and the gang of wicked people. You are taken away from that occultism. And then you come to know the Lord. And it says, because you have been cleansed and washed and pardoned and saved and delivered, now your name is written in the book of life. And let's see what the Lord is saying about that book of life. We're looking at Luke chapter 10, verse 19 and verse 20. Luke chapter 10, I'm reading to you from read from verse 17. And the 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And he said unto them, behold, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Praise the Lord. That promise is still for you today. That promise is still holding firm today. I give unto your power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you from this day till you die in Jesus' name. Look at verse 20 now. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not. You know the joy of people that do not know the word of God. They do not know the mind of God. They do not know the essential thing, the important thing, the most important thing, the indispensable thing. They say, the sick, they are getting healed, and demons are being cast out. We have this miracle, we have this miracle. That's wonderful. But Jesus said, notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written where? In heaven. That's the joy of the child of God. Sins forgiven, guilt taken away, condemnation gone, reconciled unto God. Now you are a child of God, and because you are a child of God now, your name is written in the book of life. And at the time of the great tribulation, the remnant that will call upon the name of the Lord, they'll be saved. And as they are getting saved, their names will be in the book of life. And the word of God says, those people with their names in the book of life, those are the people that will eventually be delivered, and they'll be spared from all the calamities that will come upon the people. Then they will not go to an eternal hell. They will go to heaven, and they will be with the Lord when he establishes his millennial kingdom. I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. In Revelation chapter 20, we're looking at the book of life. Revelation chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the whole earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. That's the book of records. Every evil thing that those unrepentant people, wicked people, what they have done, the books will be opened. But if you have been born again, your name is not in the book of records. It's not like in the book of, you know, all the population of the world. Your own is different because you are now a child of God. You are in the book of life. I pray you'll experience that in Jesus' name. It says, and another book, singular, another book was opened, which is the book of life. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to their works, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. To escape the lake of fire, to escape eternal punishment, to escape eternal hell, and to escape that suffering that will be upon people for ages and ages unending and for all eternity, your name must be in the book of life. Let's look at chapter 21, verse 27. Chapter 21, verse 27. And there shall in no wise, in no case, for no reason, enter into it anything that defileth. You see that? There shall not enter into heaven anything that defileth. You know, I pity the people that just go to church. They say, I go to church. Many churches in the land, and their preachers and their teachers and their Sunday school teachers or whoever, or their priests, they're not telling them, ye must be born again. And many people just think it's church, church, church. Just go to church, and that's enough. And many people who are religious like that, they think, I'm all right, I'm okay, but are you born again? Are you a child of God? Is your name in the book of life? Because the Bible says, there shall in no wise enter into that holy city, into the heavenly city, into the heavenly Jerusalem, any sin that defileth. You know what defiles? Fornication, adultery, and all those evil things, they defile, they pollute. And then it says, neither whatsoever walketh abomination. All those abominable things the people do, or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. The only people that will get to heaven, and the only people that will live forever and ever in the temple of the Almighty God, will be the people whose names are written in the book of life. I pray that your name will be there. But you know, what if somebody's name had been there before? He was written in the book of life, and now he begins to toy with sin, play with sin. He even begins to toy with the Bible, and begins to tear the Bible away. Not literally, but maybe in preaching. He will take that doctrine away. I don't believe that anymore. I don't accept that anymore. One man, one wife. That's too strict. How can that be? What if your wife has gone away out of this terrible condition? How will you just remain like that? And then they take that away. I don't believe sanctification anymore. How can somebody be holy and pure and sanctified all the days of his life? Look at temptation. Look at trial. Look at this. People will make you do this and make you do that. I don't believe that anymore. They take sanctification away. Other people say, I don't think there's going to be a rapture before Great Tribulation. I think everybody will just pass through the Great Tribulation, and everything they believed before, they begin to, you know, take this away and take this away and take that away. Especially when members of their churches, you know, thank God not this church. I thank God for you, members of the church who are standing on the truth, will keep on standing on the truth in Jesus' name. But you know, in some other churches, it's not like that. You know, the preacher, especially when there's some of these people, they come and they hear the word of God. And then they go to their churches and they say, this is the word of God. And then a committee will say, hey, come on here. That thing you have gone to learn from those people, and you're reading Bible now, you want to read the whole Bible. The committee will say, you cannot preach that here. If you preach that here, we're going to stop your salary. Then they become afraid, and then they take that away. When you take it away like that from the word of God, even though you were born again before, your name was in the book of life before. Look at what happens, chapter 22 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 22, verse 19. And if any man shall take away from the words, If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life. You know, there are people that will tell you that once saved, you are forever saved. Your name is always there in the book of life. No matter what you do, even if you deny the doctrines of the Bible, even if you blaspheme God, even if you lie against God, even if you turn people's minds away from the word of God, even if you make people backslide and you make them do evil things and now they are committing sin with impunity and they don't care anymore, even if you destroy the people of God or destroy yourself and you go back into evil and sin, they say, you're forever saved. The Bible says no. If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. I pray that your name will not be taken away. That means to be faithful to the word of God and faithful to the Lord and remain abide in the word of God forever and ever. You'll remain. Revelation chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 25. Revelation chapter 2, verse 25, but that which thou hast already, hold fast till I come. Why? Because if you don't hold fast, if you drop them, if you reject them, if you deny them, if you abandon the doctrines of the word of God and say, I don't believe that anymore, I don't want to be as consecrated as I was, as serious as I was, as focused, as steadfast, as faithful to the word of God as I was, I'm taking that away, I don't accept that anymore. If you do that, it says, he'll take your name out of the book of life in which you were before. But then it says, if you want your name to remain in the book of life, it says, hold that fast which you have until I come. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. You'll reign with Christ. And as the vessels of a potter, shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father, and I will give him the morning star. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Let's come to chapter 3 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 3, from verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, this thing says he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. You know, there are people that think, you know, I'm still there, I'm still a child of God, my name is in the book of life, and the Lord is saying, you have a name that you live, you have a record that you live, because you have a lot of history behind you. People are saying, brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so, whatever they are calling you, and he says, but you are dead. Because when you backslide and go back into sin, that's death. Be watchful and strengthen the things that remain, that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. You see, the Lord is examining us and is looking at what we are doing, investigating us, evaluating us, and he says, I have not found your life, your character, your ministry, your work, your service perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, you see that? If you hear the Bible study, you come to the Bible study, and then you say, I've heard, but I'm not going to do it. I've heard, I'm not going to pay attention. I've heard, but I'm not going to obey. If you will not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I shall come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. I pray you'll be among those few. I said you'll be among those few. Not defiling your garments. You know, sin defiles our robe of righteousness. Evil. Even small sins. Small evil things. Small backslidings. Small compromises. Little things that people do. It doesn't matter. You know, a mosquito can kill as well as, say, a lion. And many people that die, don't die because lions kill them. Only few people die because lions kill them. But many people die because of these little rats and little mosquitoes. And many people, it's not the big sins that make them to perish. It's that little thing here, doesn't matter there. Those are the things that destroy them, make them to backslide. I pray you'll not backslide. That's a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. They shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, who is that? You'll be there. He that overcometh the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. I will not. I will make his name to remain there. Your name will remain there. I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. The question is your name written there? On the page, white and fair, in the book of God's kingdom, is your name written there? The Lord is about to come. And when the rapture takes place, after the rapture, there will be the great tribulation. And the church is not waiting for the great tribulation. We are waiting for the rapture. And if you remain saved and your name is the book of life, when the rapture shall take place, the dead in Christ shall rise. And then we which are alive will be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we, you and I, will be with the Lord forever in Jesus' name. To be there, our name must remain in the book of life. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. The Lord is merciful. This is still the day of grace. This is still the day of mercy. This is the day of compassion. Don't let anybody give up and say, well, I've done something bad. I've done this. I've done that. No hope. There is hope. There is hope. There is hope. God is a loving God. Today, the love of God is still available for you, for me, for every one of us. We can still call upon the Lord. And whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You can call. Check up your life. Check up your life. And be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Be cleansed in the blood of the Lamb. The Lord is merciful. Remember, the Lord is merciful. He loves you. He loves you. He appreciates you. And he's telling you, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Any guilt, any condemnation, don't wait too long. Don't wait too long. Even the prodigal son, the prodigal daughter, the prodigal father, the prodigal mother, the prodigal wife, the prodigal husband, the prodigal person that has gone far into the world of sinning. You can come back today and just say, I will arise and go to my Father. I recollect everything I've done. I repent of everything I've done. I renew my covenant with the Lord. I will not pretend as if everything is all right. That prodigal son said, I will arise and go to my Father. I will tell my Father, this is what I've done. I've sinned against heaven and against thee. I'm no more worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your hired servants. He wasn't made a servant, he was made a son. He was made a son. And the mercy of God is available for us today. Call upon the name of the Lord. The blood of Jesus Christ will wash you whiter than snow. He'll purify you, he'll purge you. If you've been saved before and then you are not sure of that salvation now, get settled with the Lord again. Get reconciled to the Lord again. And whatever has come back into your life that shouldn't be there, claim the mercy of God today. Claim the compassion of the Lord today. And claim the love of God today. If you have become careless, he will forgive you. Careless, he'll forgive you. He'll become like a coward, compromising. You know, people now push you to do things you wouldn't have done 5 years ago. You wouldn't have done 10 years ago, 20 years ago. But now you are just a compromiser. You can tell the Lord, Lord, strengthen me again. Strengthen me again that I will love you more than anything. I will honor you more than anyone, and I will obey you more than anyone. And whatever the shame, and whatever the reproach, whatever the persecution, whatever the pressure, the pain, I'll keep on serving you. I want to serve you with all my strength, all my life. I don't want anything to stand between me and the Almighty God. Call upon the Lord, and the Lord will have mercy upon you. He will have mercy upon you. He will have mercy upon you. He's merciful. He'll never leave you, never forsake you. His mercy is still there. His goodness is still there. And it says, even at the time of great suffering, at the time of great suffering, whosoever, that's you, that's me, that's us, all of us together, that's your wife, that's your husband, that's your child, that's your parent, whosoever, that's your friend, whosoever, encourage one another, whosoever will call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Even in the most terrible time, even in the most challenging time, don't allow discouragement to make you forget the mercy of God, the compassion of God, the love of God, the forgiveness available for everyone. Not time of great tribulation yet, there's mercy, there's love, there's grace, there's forgiveness, there's salvation. Make sure your name is in the book of life. Make sure your sins are forgiven. He gives you the promise. Receive the promise. Accept the promise. Wash in the blood of the Lamb by faith. Thank Him. Say, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Merciful God, loving God, compassionate Father, I thank you. The moment the prodigal son returned home, the father received him. He was forgiven, brought into the family, reconciled to the family, reconciled to God. Reconciliation is there, it's available. You don't have to perish. Even in the time of the great tribulation, the people who call upon the Lord shall be purified, purged. How much more today, this time of peace, there's sanctification, there's purification, there's purging. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Then God's favor will be upon your life. He'll watch over you everywhere you go. He'll preserve you. His love, His mercy will never leave you. We need to take this message of love to our neighbors so that they will not wait too long until after the rapture, until the great tribulation will come upon them. And then will be a time of great, great suffering. Show mercy on your neighbor. Don't allow them to remain in ignorance. Tell them of the love of God. Tell them of the mercy of God. But tell them of the calamity coming upon this world, the time of the great tribulation, great suffering coming upon this world. Are they not your friends? Talk to them. Your neighbors, talk to them. Your children, talk to them. Even your parents, politely talk to them so that they will not go through the great tribulation. If you love anybody, you want to help them to call upon the Lord so at this time of mercy and grace and love, they'll experience the mercy and the grace of God. They will not perish. Don't go to heaven alone. Take others with you. Go with other people. Call other people. Friendship evangelism, personal evangelism, effective evangelism, so that they will escape. As your name is in the book of life, you will show them how their name too will be in the book of life. And when the Lord shall come, we'll go with Him. We'll be in the air in the marriage supper of the Lamb while the great tribulation is taking place.